Next speaker, who some of you will be familiar with, is Dave Coveney. Okay, there he is over there. And Dave, you're going to tell us about...
Work and social media.
Sorry, it's here on the screen. So work and social media. So Dave, if you would please...
Hi. Oh, I have a microphone. I won't take that out. I've actually run out of hands. Notes or beer. I've got notes of beer. I was asked by Andy to do a talk here on work and social media. I think you're under some kind of illusion that I know what I'm talking about, but I'll do my best. It's just a little talk by me, David Coveney, if we're going to do it properly, we're going to say at Dave Coveney, just please. I'm going to just jump straight into the actual perceptions of work and social media, because I think for a lot of us, how many people work for a company that's got more than, say, 1,000 staff? One, two, three. So as a proportion, there's only three of us, it's maybe, 5% of the people here work for a big company. But actually, you'll find that in the less geeky world that we inhabit, it's a significantly higher proportion. And you have different perceptions in those kind of companies, from smaller ones. They're less flexible, less open to new things. So you find that perceptions of social media can be, the marketing department thinks, oh, that's wonderful, we can use it to sell stuff. That's what it's about, it's selling things. We can create a page and this is actually to raise money for a boycott climate criminals campaign. And you can run campaigns and get people to like you, you can get people to friend you, and so on. But sometimes there's also the perception of peers that it's actually a bit distracting. You get things like that coming up on Facebook, these ads, because you're on there on your private personal profile. To a lot of guys, that might be more interesting than raising some money. Others see it as confusing, and that's why TweetDeck, that's my default mode of running game. Lots of columns, lots of people talking. It's quite busy. And I show that to someone who never saw it, and they panic. But I'm not a social media consultant, that's not what I do in the business. I'm not trying to sell this, it's just what I use, it's a tool for me. And then there's others, if you type in Twitter is to Google, if you look at the things that come up, I mean, overcapacity, fancy that, down. But then you get a lot of, pointless, rubbish, waste of time. And then loads of people have created Twitter accounts, and they're like, well, now what? While we're in there, something there's an opinion that it can be inappropriate. But you can use it really, really well. Has anybody actually ever tweeted while driving? Go on, admit it. There's no police here, are there? Are there any police? No. Who's tweeted? Go on, admit it. Yeah, one, two, three. Okay, was it traffic lights? Honest. 4, 5, we've got one, 6, 8, loads of you. Brilliant, you can use social networking really, really well. But the thing is though, I think, I put less is sometimes more because it sounds deep and profound, but I'm not quite sure what I was trying to get at there, but I think what I was trying to say is that people sometimes overuse it. They get a Twitter account and they decide, okay, we've got to talk about everything, every success of the business, everything I've done, everything I see that's interesting. forgetting why people actually follow you. But actually, the reason people follow you is because of social connections, more often than not. I had a Twitter account for 6 months. I didn't know what to do with it because I didn't know anybody on Twitter. It was only when I turned up at a bar camp, you just reminded me about it, two years ago nearly, I met other people on Twitter. I met them in real life. I got a little drunk with them in the bar, in the after party. They were real people, so they were much more interesting. They're much more interesting people that you actually know what they're like. And then you make these connections. It's not about business connections. The last thing I want to do is go to a conference and then get 20 new followers who are really actually just after either a business or me as a supplier. Because I think if that's what happens, you just get a load of really boring followers. The people you're listening to, it's just going to be, yeah, we just launched a new product today. Or opening a new office. You're actually interested in the people. So I would say it's about, if you do meet people online, that's fine. That's not a bad thing. Rob, just there. Hi, Rob. Can point at you. I didn't bring it to point at this. Just people, if you're not paying attention. So you can meet people in real life through it. And that helps create those social connections. It's a virtuous circle. So you go into real life, and there you go. These are people. I know every one of these, I think, one way or the other, through social networking or some kind of contact. But they're real people. I met at Thinking Digital last month. That's me. I don't do haircuts. That's Tony Hughes, is it? From just round the corner. Andy's old colleague, yeah. Ben. Don't remember the rest of his name. What's his name? But they're real people, and I will remember them. But the point is that I met them in that situation. So I do feel that social media can start a relationship, but it works best at the sort of maintenance or expansion of real-life social contacts, people that you can actually go and have a beer with. Now, I actually think when you talk on Twitter, when you talk in any environment, you should think, would I say this in a pub surrounded by my friends? A lot of people aren't thinking that. They're thinking, hey, we've got a new product out. Yeah, imagine you went to the pub and you said to your friends, hey, we just started selling this new type of widget. Do you want to buy it? You'd sing those friends. But if your friend is aware that you happen to have that widget, he's going to choose you over somebody else. That's what it's about. It's about just make friends, make real people. And that's why when you said social media and work, I was scared because too many see it as it's a selling opportunity. And I wanted to just explain that it's not. It's just about making friends, which is very hard to get past the manager sometimes. So anyway, I'm going to just cover how I use social media and a little bit of a... it's me, not the company, because companies can't. What can companies do?
Square.
Square.
I'm not on social media. I'm a public sector organisation. I work for a university.
Yeah.
And before I actually came in there, it felt like one knew what these things were. I'm almost like an evangelist.
You think companies are square? Companies can't swear. Well, they can if it's ours. But I actually don't think one thing companies can't do is they can't socialise. No company. I've never been out for a drink with a company. I've been out where the drinks have been paid for by a company, that's great. But you know what happens when everyone knows Microsoft's paying? They get hammered. but they're not saying, hey, Microsoft, how's it going? What's happened lately? Are you still there? Are you still skiing? It doesn't happen. So So I've always said, though, that the social networks do kind of divide up. For me, anyway, this is about me, this is what I do. For me, Facebook is friends and family, and that's about it. I never do business on Facebook, ever. Twitter, I use for everyone. I don't divide up. It's just me. I talk about work, I talk about what I do, I talk about what I've done. My baby boy, you know, anything that goes. I don't care. I'm not on message here. But I don't filter. It's essentially just a stream of consciousness. So have a look at my feed and you'll see what I mean. And I use LinkedIn for business. Well, actually, like most people on LinkedIn, I never use it. I'm just on it. But, you know, fancy that. how many millions are there on LinkedIn? But apart from recruitment consultants, I don't know anyone who actually actively uses it. It's just interesting to see what your mates are up to, well, what your old colleagues are up to. I have a little story as well about social networking, when I feel like it started coming for me. And it happened in about 1994, or thereabouts, maybe 92, I can't quite remember, but 1994, I can put my finger on, has been a year when I was actively social networking. Because I enjoy killing people. Not real people, but in Doom. I really love playing Doom. And I used to go to these little LAN parties, and you could play four people at a time. This was early days. I mean, you could play against four people in deathmatch, and it was so awesome. And you can play Doom, but some people set up game servers where you could carry on playing four people, but it was still, there's something missing. And somebody told me that there's a really, really good league with the top players in the country on a system called Kix. And that's why I joined it. I had to have a reason to join it, and that's the same with any social network. You need to know, it needs to be an attraction, just like you don't go into a bar when it's empty and none of your friends are there. But you might go into a bar because, hey, there's my mate, I'll get a beer. So the bar's job is to try and keep your friends in there as long as possible to attract you. Is that right? Yeah. And make friends. I mean, the best bars I know, the barman and the owners of the bar make friends with the people who come to the bar. They don't just give them beer and show off their throws. You know. Actually, I'll have a beer now I'm talking about it. I joined Kix to get in this league. And I thought, right, I'm going to play some of the best. You know, there was Athelstan, there was Murder. These are the names we dealt with. Who was in Kix from here? Don? You were on Kix. What's your...
Later on, my
book. Pardon? Mike Nolan, all right. I'm going to look for you now. Were you on Kix? No. So we got three people who've been on Kix. But it was a social network. It was just forums, really. But you could ignore people, you could talk to them. But you had a few functions, and it was nice. Now you can friend people on it, and everything. It still exists. It's got like three active members or something. And I'm still there. I'm still paying £8 a month for... I don't even log in, but it's one of those things, like an old friend. So I hung around though, and I was joining conferences about my interests, not conferences to make, do business or anything like that, but I met a couple of people. There's Timbo Baggins. I met him in, he's a guy called Tim Bill. He was a journalist, a photojournalist, a photographer, very good one. He's now actually a server wrangler, and Dave Morton. I'm never sure what Dave Morton does, actually, but I never was. But these are both guys on Kix, top guy. But I put the at on because they're now on Twitter. So that you kind of, the same community follows you around anyway. You have the same people. And lots of other people. And actually, with them and a few others from Kix, we created an online publishing company, a group, called Speed Publications. It's now called Interconnect IT. It's the same company. And we reckoned in 1996 that the internet and the World Wide Web were the biggest things that were going to happen. We're just a bit early. So we put loads of effort, energy and time. And then I turned around and I said, you know guys, this is about early 98. I turned around and I said to them, look, we're not going to make any money out of this. I just can't see. I've been looking at the figures, the visitor stats and everything. I said, we're not going to make money until at least 2002, 2003. It never occurred to me that you don't actually have to make money in the dot-com boom to actually personally make money. More for me. That's because I never did an MBA. Well, just nobody taught me any of these things. I didn't understand finance. But we created this online publishing group, and then we got a deal with Microsoft to live blog, believe it or not, albeit using front page. But live blog, it had to be front page, Microsoft, and prove this technology. Through Microsoft, and we're going to do the RAC rally, and we had things like we had a people carrier, a load of phones and equipment, mobile office, a load of box full of phones from Orange, they were backing that and everything. It was only 2 days before the event that the actual organisers said, actually, you know what, you can't come. The hotel's booked, things printed, everything. So that kind of like broke my heart a bit. But the reason we knew Guy was through Kix, not because I was on a Kix forum for publishers or journalists or anything like that. He likes motorsport, and I like motorsport. So it was just strands pulling together. But this is what it was about. You join groups, and you talk about stuff, and you create social networks. I know I'm teaching people to suck eggs here, because I didn't know what level we were talking about. But if we look at this, Kix did teach me some things. It taught me that you make friends first, you be helpful. If you share information, people will share it with you, they'll be open with you. Be open to experiences, don't slag people off, because you can remember, everything online is semi-permanent. It fades away very, very slowly. And it's archived, and people can get hold of it, and it won't be forgotten easily. And I wish I hadn't logged on quite so drunk sometimes. But Kix, maybe the discs will get corrupted or something, who knows. Don't be anonymous as well. I actually don't think anyone should try to be too anonymous online. I think they should connect. Your personal name is your brand. Nurture it, because ultimately if you are anonymous, people will forget you, because that's the nature of it. So what's the point of putting all that work in? Really, the only point of being anonymous is to annoy people, which is fun, but let's not. So, and then, remember the Freemasons rules. Is anybody here in the Freemasons? Just shout. Okay. Well, I'm not in the Freemasons either, but the handshakes, I'll just go around you later. The Freemasons rules are, it's quite interesting, they're quite a weird organisation, because although you have to have this, there's got to be a higher power of some sort. It's non-specific, so it's open to anybody, just as long as you believe in some kind of thing, spaghetti monster, whatever. But, I'm not sure how that would go down, but one of the rules they have is they have a dinner every week or every 2 weeks or whatever. You meet at your lodge and you have a dinner and you all chat and socialise. It's a social network. Just happens to use the technology of buildings and nipples and things. What they say is, don't talk. And this is a very old network, and it's a rule that's very valid, I think. Try not to talk too much about religion or politics. And it's the same online. I've done it, we all do it, but it's an interesting rule that I always try and repeat to people. And I found the same on Kix, you get these big wars. So religions, don't talk about your faith in Christianity or OS X or Unix. Don't talk about your belief in spaghetti monsters or nothing. It's better to just accept these are deeply held beliefs, so leave them alone. So, moving from that, I just want to quickly talk, because Kix is like kind of a prehistory. I'm not talking here about new things that you can discover, but I think we can learn from the past. And if you go to the 80s, you had a lot of things started out. You had Usenet, CompuServe, Kix, AOL, The Well. I don't know if anybody was a member of any of those, but they were all, you know, breaking the ground. If we then go to the 90s, you know, MSN got started when Microsoft realised that, oh, hang on, there's like, stuff going on, we're not involved. And like Microsoft, they had to. Forums galore really started going. Blogging started in the 90s. I know everyone sees it as a noughties thing, but it did start in the 90s. And the World Wide Web, you know, what was it, 91, 92? Can anyone? No. Anyway, and then in the noughties, it's just this explosion. We had Facebook, we had Bebo, Hi5, Orkut, Twitter, Ning, Dick. The list is endless. I do think that the reasons why there's an explosion, I mean, it's kind of weird that Facebook is so big, but a lot of networks actually fail because once you reach a certain size, you gain anonymity. It's like being in a big city, and people can get abusive. If anyone's been on YouTube, if you've been on YouTube, you'll get lots of abusive comments because just there's no real sense of community. People have nothing to lose. It's just horrible, the comments on YouTube. But you just had this big explosion. Some of them have sunk without trace. I mean, Bebo's gone, I think. I don't know how Hi5 is doing, or Orkut. But then, let's actually go back a bit. And you had, this is a high-tech thing. There was this story, I don't know if anyone knows about this novel, written, it was published in 1880, called Wired Love. And it's a story about a couple who met. There were two telegraph operators. And they met in their spare time. They started chatting to each other. And telegraph operators, it seems, were doing this. They were falling in love with each other all over the place. And they were chatting away. These two, but they didn't know, you know. Is he really a girl? You know, is she as pretty as she says? and you realize there's nothing new in what we're doing today. So the rules don't really change. You could probably learn as much about online etiquette by buying this book as buying a dummy's guide to social media. So this is something that then moves on. I mean, but let's just go back a second. I mean, what other kind of social networks do you think, and what technology has been used to create social networks? I want to ask you questions. Come on, one answer.
Mobile phones?
Yes, definitely, because they allow people to communicate more easily, another step closer. Text, yeah? Let's go back further.
CB radio?
CB radios, absolutely. Weren't they mad in the 80s? Everybody had CBs. Yeah, I so wanted one, and parents wouldn't let me. I'm not bitter, so. What's the technology that allowed people to get closer together?
Bicycles?
Yeah, they do! Because you get a bicycle, you can travel further more quickly. Your scope is widened. You can find more people that are like you. So we've all got together through the power of, I don't know, Twitter, email, whatever, to get us...
Bicycles.
Some come here by bicycles. But all it was about is finding people like ourselves with shared interests that we can actually talk about stuff and be understood. If I got together 20 of my friends from badminton, so I play badminton, you wouldn't believe it, but I play badminton. If I got 20 people from the club, a lot of them would just look at me blankly. A warehouse picker has almost no interest in using this kind of stuff in work. But plenty at home. So, I put down the presenter. I've realised as well, actually, if you stand here, everyone who's taking pictures got a glowing sign saying toilet above my head. So, just... The reason why did I pick the beer up? That's another technology that helps people to get together because it breaks down barriers, it makes you a bit less inhibited, it makes you relax, makes you able to give presentations in front of 70 people. It helps. So they're all of these tools, Foursquare, Twitter, what else can I say for the listener? Gowalla, Facebook, LinkedIn, rubber banding, I don't know that network. They're all just facilitators of a life. So, you know, sometimes you may actually want to, I don't know why that thing's stuck in the corner actually, but too late now, I've nearly finished. Have I got much time left? I'll carry on. Right, so sometimes, I mean, I also like to just get into this, you know, what you may actually want to run your own social network, you may want to do something yourself. And it's not difficult, the technology is there, it's free, it just needs a bit of technical nous, or find a friend, or even, you know, you could set up a Facebook group, you've got lots of options. And for work-wise, you could set up all sorts of things. Now, if you really like hair shirts, you could set up Coveney. I know at least one network that's opened in the last 5 years using Coveney. It's called Twix, and it's full of hairy bikers. it's a bikers group off Kix, if you're ever on Kix, but Kix Bikers, notorious group. But then you've got things like Ning, which let you easily set up and lose all your data or something. You've got forum software. You could buy and pay £100 and install vBulletin. It does quite a lot of things, actually. It's powerful stuff. It's not pretty, but it's powerful. You could use WordPress. You could just blog. I mean, just in creating a blog, you've got everything happening that's needed for networking. You can create a community. And you can close it off quite easily. But if you work with WordPress, you could use something like BuddyPress, which is an open source extension to WordPress. It lets you create social networks with groups and friends and messages and so on. We do some of that stuff. That's it. I'm not selling here. It's just telling you. But the most important thing about it all is it's just have fun, meet people, have a beer, and the rest will just come naturally. Thank you. Oh, some credits, just because, you know, Flickr photos I used. So, anyway, thank you.